You're visible, audible, and your slides are up. So,
okay, the slides are up, and you can hear me, right? Can you hear me?
Yes, you're audible, as well as visible, yeah.
Okay, so the lecture is on the clinical implications of the glucocorticoid signaling system. And you will see that there are many. For us endocrinologists, the story starts with a Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine in 1950 to Edward Kendall, Thaddeus Reichstein, and Philip Hentz. Philip Hentz was an internal medicine doctor and a rheumatologist. And they got the Nobel Prize for isolating glucocorticoids and for treating patients with rheumatoid arthritis. It was a major step. My lecture has the following pieces. Number one, I'll say a few words about the new biology and complexity, because glucocorticoids, as you will see, have many complex actions on the human cell and on the human organism. Then I'll say a few words about the molecular actions of glucocorticoids. In one slide, I'm going to show you the pervasiveness of glucocorticoid actions. And finally, I will talk about the expanding clinical implications. Okay, let's start with new biology and complexity. As you know, complex systems contain multiple interactants, let's say cells or molecules or hormones. They're complex. They're self-organizing. That's how life works. It's self-organizing. They're adapting through feedback loops. They're resilient to perturbations, and they have emergent properties. So we have units, can be genes, molecules, cells, modules, networks, systems, and programs. And glucocorticoids are involved in the entire complex system of the human organism. Let me show you why humans are so complex. First of all, we have very complex cells. Remember, we have 6 billion bases in our DNA in a single cell. 2% of these bases are expressed as proteins, but 98% are not expressed, and they used to call them junk DNA. It's not junk DNA, it's full of genes and regulatory regions. We have 20,000 protein coding genes, but we have also 24,000 non-coding RNA coding genes, which are very important in regulation. We have many molecules that are involved in the regulation of the genome, non-coding RNAs, microRNAs, long non-coding, pi RNAs, cRNAs, etc. And finally, we have over 1 million regulatory regions within those 6 billion bases that I mentioned. So to think about in the post-genomic era or epigenomic era, we must speak about mutations, changes in the genome, and epimutations, changes in the regulation of the genome. Now, what are the molecular actions of glucocorticoids? How do they work, these steroid hormones? Well, they're part, as you know, of the stress system. Here is the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis. Cortisol is the end hormone. Almost all cells in the human body contain glucocorticoid receptors. There is only one region that doesn't have them, and that's the suprachiasmatic nucleus of the hypothalamus. The secretion of ACTH is regulated by CRH and AVP synergistically, and the system works not only through the HPA axis, but also through the arousal system called locus coeruleus, that's the center of the arousal system, and the autonomic nervous system, particularly the sympathetic nervous system. In the periphery, we have production of norepinephrine and epinephrine. Both stimulate production of IL-6. And strangely enough, we found that the amygdala, the central nucleus, operates with CRH, and so do some of the postganglionic sympathetic neurons. They produce CRH, which CRH degranulates mast cells. So we end up with glucocorticoids, norepinephrine, epinephrine, IL-6, and CRH, and other molecules, and they all regulate the immune response and inflammation. Now, steroids are lipids, so they have no problem crossing the plasma membrane. They go into the cytoplasm and they bind to the glucocorticoid receptor. which is sitting in a ligand-friendly position, together with various molecules here that are either heat shock proteins or immunophilins. Once the glucocorticoid binds to the receptor, the complex is liberated from the heteroligomer and moves through the nuclear pore into the nucleus. And we need ATP for this. It's a system that does this transport. Now, in the nucleus, the glucocorticoid receptor can work as a dimer or as a monomer. As a dimer, it interacts with the glucocorticoid response elements to regulate genes either positively or negatively. As a monomer, perhaps as a dimer, it interacts with other transcription factors, such as the transcription factors that mediate the actions of cytokines, such as those of TNF or IP1. And through those transcription factors, they regulate the activity of another set of genes. So we have two types of effects, through GREs and through other transcription factors. Now, when the glucocorticoid dimer binds to the GRE, that attracts some molecular machines. The first one is the SWI-SNF complex, comes close, binds, and then that attracts a second one, the coactivator complex. And that attracts a third one, the TRIP-TRAF complex, which eventually regulate the activity of the genes. Of course, the glucocorticoid receptor is recycled in the cell. Some of it is ubiquitinated and degraded by proteasomes, and some of it comes back in the cytoplasm and is employed for a second time. Now, the glucocorticoid receptor gene in humans and in most primates expresses two alternate splice products, one that codes for the GR-alpha gene, that's the active receptor, and a second one that codes for the GR-beta receptor, which is very similar to GR-alpha, but it has a difference here at the end of the molecule, at the C-terminal, and this does not bind glucocorticoid, whereas the regular receptor, the alpha, binds cortisol, this one doesn't, okay? Now, the glucocorticoid receptor, the alpha, has the immunogenic domain, the DNA binding domain, and the ligand binding domain. The same is true for this, but the ligand binding domain in the beta does not work. So when we look at the glucocorticoid receptor alpha, in addition to the DNA binding domain and the ligand binding domain, we have the so-called hinge region here, H. We have the part of the molecule that binds heat shock proteins in immunophilins. The part of the molecule that dimerizes, both alpha and beta have dimerization domains and HSP binding domains. There are two nuclear translocation domains here and here, you can see. And there are two transactivation domains. One is in the immunogenic domain and one other, it's very close to the DNA binding domain. So these are all the functions that are combined for the glucocorticoid receptor to exert its actions. Things became even more complex when we realized that the glucocorticoid receptor alpha gene and the beta gene, which are very similar, as I said, just alternative splicing, produce 8 N-terminal products each. So we have actually 256 combinations of glucocorticoid receptor alpha and beta isoform that exerts their effects on the human genome. It's gotten already very complex. Each cell has a different number of receptors, a different number of isoforms, and so forth. So the end effect is stochastic. Now, the glucocorticoid, let's say cortisol or corticosterone that binds to the cell, can be metabolized, inactivated, or activated. It can cross into the nucleus and interact with a lot of other proteins. Just to show you the complexity, that's why I put this slide on. There are multiple products, cellular products, that interact with the glucocorticoid receptor. We know at least 120. Now, in ancient Greek, there is an inscription at the Oracle of Delphi saying everything in moderation. So there is an old curve, it's called the curve of Aristotle, which said that homeostatic systems, and let me say that glucocorticoids are a homeostatic system, work well somewhere in the middle. There is too little or too much. In both situations, we have a problem. So here we have good homeostasis, eustasis. On the two sides, we have bad homeostasis. So on this side, we have Addison's. On this side, we have Cushing syndrome. Now, here are the effects of glucocorticoid excess and deficiency. These are reminiscent of Cushing syndrome and these of Addison. Well, if you take each tissue separately, you'll find out that if you have glucocorticoid hypersensitivity in any of these systems, organ systems in the body, you're gonna have problems. For example, from the CNS, you're gonna get insomnia, anxiety, depression, defective cognition. That's what happens in Addison. In the liver, you're gonna get increased gluconeogenesis and liposynthesis and insulin resistance. In the fat, you're gonna accumulate fat. In the muscles, you're gonna get insulin resistance. In the vessels, hypertension, and so forth. The opposite exactly happens in the tissues when we have glucocorticoid resistance. And it seems that each tissue, maybe each cell is different as far as glucocorticoid sensitivity is concerned. And here we have the normal activity of the HPA axis. Here we have a patient who has glucocorticoid resistance. And here's a patient that has glucocorticoid hypersensitivity. So what do you see in the resistance? You're gonna see activation because of negative feedback. It's not working well. You're gonna get increased CRH and AVP secretion, increased ACTH secretion, and from the adrenals, you're gonna get increased androgens, increased cortisol, and increased mineralocorticoids. Okay, so that's the pathophysiology of glucocorticoid resistance. On the other side, you have the pathophysiology of glucocorticoid hypersensitivity, the opposite. Low cortisol, right? Low ACTH, low DOC, low androgens. Exactly the mirror image. Here are the first two patients with glucocorticoid resistance that I saw them at the NIH in about 1980. My boss, Lynn Laurier, and myself brought them from Holland, they're Dutch, and they presented with very high levels of cortisol and no Cushing syndrome stigmata. They look normal. Although this particular, the father, this is father and son, the father had severe hypertension and hypokalemic alkalosis, and he was short, shorter than the son. So we studied these people and eventually we studied many more cases. And I can give you a summary of the clinical manifestations of glucocorticoid resistance. They have apparently normal glucocorticoid function in most cases. So there are many asymptomatic people. There are people who have chronic fatigue and there are children that can have hypoglycemia. They have mineralocorticoid excess, hypertension, hypokalemic alkalosis. They have androgen excess, which in children, it can be presented with ambiguous genitalia at birth in girls, clitoromegaly, premature adrenarche, gonadotropin-independent precocious puberty. In females, adult females, we see acne, hirsutism, male pattern hair loss, menstrual irregularities, oligonovulation, and hypofertility. They look almost identical to women with polycystic ovary syndrome. The difference is that they have high cortisol. There is increased HPAX activity, and you can measure ACTH and cortisol and they're elevated. The men can develop adrenal rest in the testes, so they can be associated with oligospermia. And there's been one patient that developed a corticotropinoma. And we looked at the actual tumor, and the tumor was resistant to glucocorticoids, and probably that's the reason it grew, the adenoma. Now, how do we make the diagnosis? First of all, we must not see features of Cushing syndrome, clinical. They have normal elevated ACTH, elevated cortisol, increased 24-hour urinary free cortisol, normal circadian and stress-induced pattern of cortisol and ACTH, resistance of the axis to dexamethasone. And then if you want to see in cellular assays how they behave, you can do a thymidine incorporation assay where there is increased resistance to dexamethasone suppression, or a binding assay where you can find either decreased concentration of the receptor or decreased affinity. And then, of course, you can do molecular studies and find mutations, deletions of the GR gene receptor, functional studies of the mutant receptors, etc. Here you see a lot of glucocorticoid receptor abnormalities causing glucocorticoid resistance. It can be familiar or it can be sporadic. It's a genetic disorder, though. The defects can be anywhere on the molecule. And typically, if you take white cells from somebody and look at the effects of dexamethasone and how it activates an artificial gene, the MMTV gene, you can see nice effect stimulation. Here is no glucocorticoid, no receptor rather. And then you can see total lack of receptor activity, decreased receptor activity, etc. This is the kind of studies we do to prove that the receptor isoform that we have isolated has problems. Now, in addition to the resistance syndrome, we have also the hypersensitivity syndrome. And this must be common, but people don't think about it most of the time. They sent me a patient from Latin America who had Cushing syndrome manifestations, such as obesity, metabolic syndrome, etc. And she had decreased or low normal HPA axis activity. She just wouldn't produce enough cortisol. We did an ACTH test. She was not secreting a lot of cortisol. So by definition, she should have hypersensitivity. So we looked into her receptor. You can see here there is a mutation here, which increases the activity of the receptor. That's what you see here. This is a normal, and here's the patient. This is the only person that has been really described with pathologic hypersensitivity due to the receptor. However, there is another symptom which is more common. There have been 6 reports. One of them is shown here. It's a little girl, pre-pubertal, who went to the doctor for Cushing syndrome, you can see here. And the doctor measured cortisol, and the cortisol was almost undetectable, very low. They sent them from Thessaloniki to Athens for studies. We did a full complement of studies, and I can tell you that the glucocorticoid receptor gene was entirely normal. However, this disease is called transient glucocorticoid hypersensitivity. Why? Because it lasts a few months, and then gradually by itself, it spontaneously goes away. So we have the idea that most likely we're dealing with some kind of an infection, probably viral infection. And when we look at the cDNA of white cells from this patient, while she was diseased and when the disease went away, you could easily see that she had some kind of an infection or inflammation, because NF kappa B target genes were very elevated. We still haven't found the virus. I've seen 2 other children with this. We don't have an answer yet. But think about it. Now, in addition to the glucocorticoid receptor, once you check this protein here, it's called FKBP5, which is an immunophilin. It's bound to the receptor. Because this immunophilin basically regulates the activity of the receptor. It's an important regulator. It's a feedback. And you can see here. And in fact, if you have mutations or polymorphisms close to the gene, of this particular gene, the immunophilin gene, you can get hyperactive HPA axis, you can see here, and this has been associated with depression and some hypercortisolism. Anyways, I told you the various tissues work differently, and if you have low free cortisol and high sensitivity, you may be okay. You may regulate it. If you have high cortisol and low sensitivity, it's the opposite. However, if you just happen to have an HPA axis, which is hyperactive and hypersensitive tissue, then you're going to develop the problem. Hard to do these studies in humans. However, this has been studied, the phenomenon in mice. And it works like this. It's a matter of tissue sensitivity. Now, as I told you, the glucocorticoid receptor interacts with many different molecules. And we found that by cutting the receptor into pieces and by using it as a bait to bind substances that bind to it. And we find a lot of those. They're shown here. And they all have functional importance. It binds to SMAD6, which is part of the TNF of the TGF-beta system. Bound to G-protein beta. It alters the activity of G-proteins. Binds to Coupe transition factor, to CDK5-35, to VPR, which is an HIV protein. And finally, the one I'm going to show you a few data is binding to clock, which is part of the biological clock. It's a transcription factor, which together with another one is able to exert the circadian rhythm that people have. That's what the regulation happens. It happens in the suprachiasmatic nucleus. However, all tissues have this system. And basically what the suprachiasmatic nucleus does is it coordinates all the tissues. And if you move from one zone, time zone to another, then it takes a while for the central regulator at the suprachiasmatic nucleus to come back to normal. That's 3 or 4 days. Anyway, you can see here the GR signaling system and the various systems with which we have found interactions. Affects almost every function. Viral systems, G-protein couple receptors, growth factors, small G-protein systems, TNF-alpha fast, apoptosis, circadian rhythm, the clock beam out, and even energy and nutrients stress system, AMPK, GAS5, LXR, and other molecules. So let me just say a few words about the interaction with the clock transcription factor. This binds in this location, and basically, the clock transcription factor has 24-hour changes. It's the day-night change, the circadian change. So that corresponds to the rotation of the Earth. Okay, there are other rhythms. I'm not going to talk about those now. It's not involved there. However, as I told you, the clock system is everywhere. There is no tissue that doesn't have it. And the central clock in the suprachiasmatic nucleus regulates all of these functions. So you expect uncoupling of the system from metabolism or immunity to have negative effects. Now, about 10% of the mammalian transcriptome oscillates with the 24-hour rhythm. And this can be the clock system control genes, but also there can be other downstream genes. But it's 10%, so it's a large proportion. Now, as I told you, there is a transcription loop that develops this rhythm. It's intrinsic. It's using light primarily and an activity as Zeitgebers. It's composed of this dimer, clock beam out, and there are other proteins, other transcription factors, and they all together operate in this system. It's a feedback control system, which goes up and down over 24 hours. And here is the system. We know it exactly what proteins there are. And because it's so important, there is an accessory auxiliary loop that stabilizes it. So there are many molecules, as you can see. Now, a few years ago, and a lot of years ago, actually, time passes fast, we found that the circadian rhythm transcription factor clock BMAL, as I mentioned, regulates the transcription activity of the glucocorticoid receptor through acetylation. Now, what is clock BMAL? Clock BMAL, the, the clock component, is basically a histone acetyl transferase, which is homologous to one of the glucocorticoid receptor coactivators, the P160s. We have three of those, such as GRIP1. Anyway, it does acetylate the receptor. And what you see here on the left is, in the absence of acetylation, the receptor is very active. Okay. And in the presence of acetylation, what happens during the night and early morning hours, the receptor is much more inactive. And it's much more inactive because these acetyls are bound close to the hinge region. That's what you see here, down here. And they alter the charge of the receptor. The DNA is negative, as you know. The receptor becomes negative. Normally, it's positive. And you have some distance between the GREs and the other transcription factors and the receptor. And the result is that in the evening and early morning hours, our tissues are very sensitive to glucocorticoids compared to morning. Now, we know that the SP axis has this kind of rhythmicity, right? It's up in the morning, goes down in the evening, and that goes on. And the question is, what's happened in the human? Do we have changes in the sensitivity of the tissues to glucocorticoids during the day? So we did study that. And basically, we found that this is the normal cortisol rhythm, right? This rhythm on top is a rhythm of a stressed person, chronically stressed or depressed. Whenever we have hyperactivation of the stress system, the curve takes this shape. And the more activated it is, the more flat it becomes. And here is the sensitivity of the tissues. Anyway, we studied healthy volunteers. We sampled them. And we measured everything at 8 a.m. and 8 p.m. And this is the night. And basically, yes, the human receptor is acetylated in the morning, less acetylated in the evening. And here are the rhythms of clock and BMAL and PER1, CRY1, and ROR alpha. These are the major regulation of the rhythm. And then we check glucocorticoid target genes that you see here. These are positive regulated, and you can see that there is a circadian rhythm. Not always, so not all genes do exactly the same. However, generally, there is this rhythm. And then we looked at genes that are suppressed by the glucocorticoid receptor, such as interferon gamma or IL-1 or IL-12. Then we saw similar changes. Not in all genes. There is some specificity. So the way to think about it is that we have the central clock, which regulates the activity of the hypothalamus, CRH and AVP. And there is a peripheral clock where the clock GMAL regulates the activity, the sensitivity of target tissues. And there is a loop here, as you can see. And of course, we don't forget that there is another major loop, and that's from the central clock to the adrenal cortex directly, where you get potentiation in the morning and decrease in the evening. Now, if you take any animal model or humans with mutations of these particular genes that I mentioned before, the clock genes, you get something very interesting. Loss of circadian rhythm means a glucocorticoid excess picture. They look like Cushing's syndrome. They die younger if they have hypercortisolism. And the reason is what I told you before about the changes in the sensitivity of the tissues and the coordination with the brain. So we found that clock system changes or AFP axis increase leads to similar metabolic and immune pathologies related to hypercortisolism. Obesity, metabolic syndrome, and immune dysfunction, and as if due to a hyperactive stress system. So there is a TH1 to TH2 shift and some suppression of inflammation. Now, what are the situations where we get this uncoupling and the problems? Chronic stress with evening cortisol elevations, endogenous or exogenous Cushing syndrome, trans time zone travel, and night shift work. All of these conditions, we have chronic stress problems, cardiometabolic disease. So this is the normal cortisol. This is GR acetylation. This is glucocorticoid sensitivity of target tissues, high in the evening. This is the opposite pattern. Here you have stress, and here you have shifts. Both in stress and in shifts, you're gonna get increased glucocorticoid activity. So in the end, it's like having glucocorticoid hypersensitivity. Okay, and its pathologic consequences. I don't wanna make it much more complex, but I just wanna tell you that the glucocorticoid receptor interacts with various histone acetyltransferases, not only CLOC, and there are histone deacetylases, like SIRT1, which deacetylate the receptor. So there is a rhythm, and an important step in this rhythm is the hormone bisphatin, right, and NAD, and we have major effects in metabolism and inflammation. Now, the second interesting molecule that we isolated that bound very tightly to the glucocorticoid receptor was GAS5. It's a non-coding, long non-coding RNA. It's about 600 bases long. You find it in cells in the G0 phase. If you starve a cell, it produces a lot of GAS5. And its physiology functions that we know so far is inhibition of the mTOR system, and that by RED1 and other inhibitors. And in other words, it suppresses cellular growth and proliferation. But it does some other important thing. This molecule that you see here, the secondary structure, has two GREs, which we examine separately. And this GRE here is active. It binds to the glucocorticoid receptor better than DNA GRE. So you have a kind of RNA GRE that binds the receptor and prevents it from binding to the glucocorticoid genome. This is the GRE that's active. That's how it enters in the big groove, the large groove of DNA. And this is how we feel about it. Cells that are resting need not to have catabolism. So the effects of glucocorticoids and other growth factors are blocked by GAS5, by this particular non-coding RNA. So GAS5 is a growth arrest related RNA. It's a GRE mimic, and it must be part of an adaptive response to starvation, saving energy resources. In one slide, the pervasions of glucocorticoid actions. The glucocorticoid dexamethasone, that's how the studies were done, shows that 12% of the human genome responds positively and 8% negatively. Therefore, 1 in 5 genes is affected by glucocorticoids. These genes affect multiple functions, and you can see here metabolism, immune response. And it's very fascinating when you look at the immune response. In most systems, like complement, cytokines, enzymatic mediators, etc., you have both suppressive activity and stimulatory activity. Same thing with innate recognition. The only system that's only negative is antigen presentation. That's why glucocorticoids are so good in blocking development of new antibodies, because it blocks antigen presentation by dendritic cells or macrophages. And I finished with expanding clinical implications. Now we know that in addition to the familiar sporadic glucocorticoid resistance, there is glucocorticoid resistant bronchial asthma, rheumatoid arthritis, systemic lupus erythematosus, ulcerative colitis, acute respiratory distress syndrome, and sepsis. COVID appears to be a very important. RDS due to COVID is responsive. The only drug it's responsive to is glucocorticoid, either dexamethasone or methylprednisolone. Also, depression, we have resistance. And hypersensitivity, we have the rare syndrome that I mentioned, which can be generalized or transient. And then we have visceral type obesity with fat tissue, which is especially sensitive to glucocorticoids, insulin resistance, carbohydrate intolerance, hypertension, age-related insulin resistance and lipodystrophy syndrome. We have two proteins of the HIV that increase sensitivity of tissue to glucocorticoids, and again, depression has been associated. And in the general population, there are these four polymorphisms. This one here makes somebody a little more resistant than the others. And same is true for GR beta polymorphism, which also increases the resistance. So these people with these polymorphisms have a better body composition, a healthier metabolic profile, better survival, low risk of dementia and depression. And here we have the glucocorticoid hypersensitive, these two polymorphisms, where you have more body fat, less in body mass, insulin resistance, metabolic syndrome manifestations, and depression. So even in the normal population, there are polymorphisms that change a little bit our sensitivity to glucocorticoids. And I'll finish with this, with the immune system. A major action of glucocorticoids in the immune system is through the NF-kappa-B system, okay? So inflammation is stimulated by NF-kappa-B, and glucocorticoids are the brake, okay? And here what happens in severe infection or inflammation. Initially, you have pro-inflammatory responses, which can lead to multiple organ dysfunction. But later on, we have the anti-inflammatory response, which tends to balance the pro-inflammatory response. But you can, again, you can get a multiple organ dysfunction. And this is needed for gram-negative bacteria, and this is needed for gram-positive bacteria, for reasons we don't understand. And here are people with RDS, acute respiratory distress syndrome. And here we started giving them glucocorticoids, randomized. TNF-alpha in people who got glucocorticoid, not placebo, you can see TNF-alpha went down. IL-1 beta went down in plasma. And IL-6 went down within about 10 days. Takes time, doesn't work immediately. And here you see the nuclear factor kappa B, which is elevated both in people who got placebo or glucocorticoid. And you can see the people who got glucocorticoid, the NF kappa B in the nucleus was less. There is a balance between glucocorticoids and NF kappa B. And the same thing happened with the subunits of NF kappa B. Here is the P50 and here is the P65. Now, as I said, VPR and another one, TAT, interact with the glucocorticoid initiation complex and influence its activity. And here you see how VPR binds to GR and the P160s, and how TAT binds to P300 CBP. And together, these increase a lot the sensitivity of tissues to glucocorticoids. Here's one of the first people we saw at NIH. You can see with lipodystrophy, the buffalo ham and the abdomen. Here you see a model before she got AIDS and after she got AIDS. So you can see the lipodystrophy, what happens. And the viral infection itself can make do this. You see here the atrophy. And I'd like to finish with a progress note that a student, medical student, wrote for Dr. Fuller Albright, the father of modern endocrinology. He was the first to think that deficiency in the function of the hormone can result not only from deficiency of the hormone, but also inability of the tissues to respond to the hormone. And this was pseudo-hypoparathyroidism. So thank you very much.